Good morning, the guys that come into church on time and don't stand out in the lobby. I appreciate you guys so much for being here and present. All of the people that are coming in right now are what they call slackers.
The Kraus children than their parents.
Good work. Now, socializing is fun, but at the expense of the worship team, we do feel hurt.
Yeah.
It really pains us to see you guys coming in late.
And online, if you're joining us online, thank you for being on time.
Unless you're watching this later, in which case, do better. Oh, boy. So we're going to stand and worship under this fun, cold start. You should have seen earlier, the first service, I'm scaring Maddie, we sang two different notes to start this whole set because it's a cappella. It was really awkward.
Right note.
This is actually the third service. The first one was very short.
Yes. All right, so I'm excited to worship. We got a nice day outside. Let's enjoy this beautiful morning, shall we?
Lord, I find you in the seeking. Lord, I find you in the dark.
Thank you.
spiritual part of this service where Scott tunes his guitar. You'll be thankful for it later.
He has to do it. Us beautiful. There's a lot of crumminess to our life. There's a lot of bad choices that we make and a lot of things we do to hurt ourselves and others, God, and you wash that all away. God, I just ask that we stay positive with ourselves, that we know that because of you, because of your grace, because of you dying and changing the script, God, we are beautiful, that we are worth time, that we can feel like we deserve the joy and the happiness because you've given it to us. I know it's really easy, especially for me, to beat myself up, to feel like I'm not good enough, to feel like I'm worthless, and without you, that's true. But I'm lucky that I have you. And we are all lucky to be able to be in your presence and to know that you love us through it all and that you've changed everything. God, I just ask that you just continue to stir that up in us. You remind us that we are made in your image, that we are made perfect through you. Not by our own doing, God, but by your grace. We worship you and we praise you for that. We love you. Amen.
Good morning, Hill City. In person and in law, and if you're online, welcome. Yes, they're inline skating to get online at church. Yes, so for anyone new here, we have a welcome table that is being manned by Ben Skorsky this morning, so go check it out. He'll have answers for you, like what we believe, what we're involved in as a church, ways to get involved at church with small groups, life groups, volunteering opportunities like youth group, and things of that nature. Here at Hill City, we believe in the gift of giving, and you can do so by, there's a Dropbox in the back. We also can take payment online or through our application. We also have a prayer team who is here and willing to pray for you during the last two songs of the service. We also have prayer teams throughout the week. Go ahead, if you have prayer requests, you can submit them in the Dropbox as well. All right, speaking of online presence, we have Facebook, Instagram, and at Hill City Hudson, our website. Go ahead and follow us on that. You can find out things and see the Ask Aaron segment. We are in desperate need of questions. Ask away so Aaron has stuff to talk about during his segment. All right. And then a few more announcements. We have the Dames Retreat on May 8th. We also have Gents this Tuesday. And join us next Sunday for our Mother's Day service with a special treat for moms. So.
Special?
Yes. Yes.
It's a threat.
I was gonna say, I don't know if that sounds good.
No. Well, that's the last time you're ever going to see that, maybe. Or maybe I'll... Yay. Thanks, lifetime friend Eric Fredrickson. Guys, We're at the end of a series called Canceled, but if you've missed the whole thing up until now, don't worry, today is still going to make sense. We've been talking about this idea that canceling things and people has been invading our culture, but that really the only one with the power and the substantial reasoning to cancel anything or anyone is God, because he is our source, he is the standard by which all things have been established and should be judged, and that when people try to become judge, jury, and executioner, the goalposts move, and that's been happening a lot in our 21st century world. But as a society, we want to, you know, steer clear of cancel culture. As Christians in community, we want to instead cancel the sin in our lives and urge other followers of Jesus to do the same, so that we can cease playing God and begin trying to please God. And we've been studying this word, apodithemi, which means to cast off, to put aside, to sort of lay off everything that is of our flesh, of our sinful nature, and instead to seek after the things of God and to try to become more like him. Paul writes to the church in Ephesus and says that we are to put off our old self, which belongs to our former manner of life and is corrupt in its deceitful desires, and instead put on a new self that's created after the image and the likeness of Christ Jesus. And so that's what we're trying to do. That's what we've been trying to do. And I just have to be honest with you all. I've had kind of a long week. Anybody else here just had a long week? You're tired. You're good. For you. Here's the deal. I know that I have not been like in manual labor all week. You know, like Jeffrey and Donna Smith put a new roof on their house this weekend. That was not me. Okay, but Monday through Wednesday, my brother and I were out of town for a little bit. And you know, when you go out of town, your week just sort of gets thrown off and out of sorts. Well, Thursday, I had flag football practice for my son and eight of his closest 7 and 8 year old friends, which is just as awful as it sounds. And just kidding, it's a lot of fun to be their coach. And on Friday, because yesterday I was participating, our kids go to Trinity Academy here in town, and they had a gala last night. And so they golf on Saturdays, and someone paid for my wife and I to go golfing. Now, Emily was the captain of the girls' golf team in high school. I have golfed less than the number of fingers I have in my life. And so in order to not embarrass myself, Friday I went out with Max, our pastoral intern, and we went golfing, and he says it's golfing. I call it chase, because I hit the ball and then I have to go find it, and when I don't find it, I come out with three other people's ball, and I'm like, I win. I put one in, I took three out. Great. So I did that, and then Friday night we had some family stuff, and then Saturday I got up and I coached flag football yesterday. Again, it's like herding cats. It's a lot of fun, rewarding in a way, I guess. But then yesterday, spent the whole afternoon golfing, and last night, for the third time in a row now, I got to auctioneer at the gala for the live auction. And guys, I have no idea what I'm doing. I just make fun of people and they laugh, and then they spend a lot of money. Someone spent $10,000 on a parking spot. And it's literally 6 inches from the next spot, and it's just separated by a white line. And I tell them that. I was very clear about that. They love children. And I sang that Sarah McLachlan song for them a few times that we've been sharing together. I'm not going to sing it, because the point of me telling you all this is I'm wiped. Like, my voice earlier today, we were going to sing that last song, and I'm supposed to sing this really beautiful arcing high O part, and I went for it, and the only thing that came out was squeak. And I was just like, I'm going to sing it like a girl. And I did. And if you noticed, Jodell, I'm assuming, good job. If you didn't, I win. Here's the reason I tell you all of this. Today's topic, today's thing that we're canceling is apathy. And apathy is basically best described as this. Meh. I mean, that's what apathy is, right? It's just a lack of care or concern, no desire, no effort. And all of us are probably in this place where it's like, I don't feel apathetic, Aaron. I've got my kids. I've got my job. I've got my parents. I've got all this stuff going on. I am anything but apathetic in life. And that's probably true for everyone in this room. As it pertains to life, we are all very busy a lot of the time. But today I want to talk about apathy as it pertains to our faith. Because I truly believe that the biggest problem facing the American church in 2021 is apathy, and I want to explain that to you, but first, I showed a clip from The Office last week, and I got so many emails telling me how amazing of an experience it was, I thought I'd try it again, because you can never have too much of a bad thing. So, Megan, let's show that clip. Okay, here's the reason I show that clip. That's what happens when you leave things unattended. That's what happens when you leave things unattended in your life, right? Dwight leaves his phone. It's right there. Jim picks it up, does something crazy with it. It is dangerous to leave things unattended, whether it's your phone or your family, whether it's your friendships or your faith. When you put something on the back burner and you don't pay a ton of attention to it, it starts to suffer. If you don't believe me, just ask your lawn or your garden. Every year, around this time, Emily and my mom and they get together and they plan and they plant and I till the soil and we put down the weed-stopping mats and we do all this work. And by September, my mom is eating food and I am taking a weed whacker and a machete to my backyard. Because if you leave something unattended, it'll start to just go in its own direction. And lots of times, as a pastor, people come to me and they say things and I'm honest to God, I don't judge people when they say these things except for I try to figure out what they mean by them. But stop me if you've ever heard one of these before. I'm not really a church person. I'm religious, or I'm not religious, but I'm spiritual. I don't know what I think about the whole Jesus thing. I don't do organized religion. But I do think that Jesus was a good moral teacher. This one I enjoy a lot. I haven't read the Bible, but I would like to tell you all the ways I disagree with it. I haven't read it. I mean, that's like me and Great Expectations. Pip sounds awful, but that's only because that's all I know about him. There's this one. I want to live a better life, and I'm a Christian, but I don't really have a church that I belong to because churches are just buildings. I think when it really comes down to it, all of us and everybody we know is asking a very simple and extremely short question. And guys, we're talking about apathy this week, okay? So I wrote the question in the most apathetic way possible. Here is the question that everyone is asking. Why? I mean, that's the question. Why? Why? Why do I need to invest in my faith? Why should I read my Bible or follow what it teaches? Why do I need to belong to a church family? Why should I attend a small group? Why is it important that I bring my family to church on Sunday or we watch together online? Why do I have to raise my kids in the church and in the faith or stay on top of what they're being taught in school or who they're hanging out with? Why does my faith have to impact and influence every aspect of my life. People are just asking, why? Because Aaron, I have a job and I have kids and I have a spouse and I have to take care of that house and everything around. I have so much going on. Can't I just come to church on Sunday? Isn't that enough? Pastors work one day a week. Why can't I just come to church one day a week? I said that last night at the gala, and then some guy raised his hand and goes, God works 7 days a week. And I was like, no way. So do I. It's called being on call, right? None of you want to like wind up in an emergency room and call your pastor and it's like, dude, it is Tuesday. He will not be answering his phone today. Like, no, that's, I mean, that's part of my job. But people just want to ask why. And all of these why questions are valid. And as your pastor, or at least the pastor that you're listening to right now, I have a very simple and short answer. And when you hear me say it, you're going to think, oh, that's a little snarky, and that's a little trite, and that's a... I am not being trite. I am not being sarcastic. This is my actual answer. It is not insincere. My answer to the why question is this. Because honest to goodness, I have said, I believe with everything in my being that the largest problem facing the American church is apathy. And that's what I want to cancel today. Believe it or not, before COVID hit, I had an entire series of messages about apathy planned. They were written, not like the whole message was written, but all the verses and everything outlined, ready to go. And I was going to bring it. And then we went downtown and I thought, that's not a good topic to talk about downtown Hudson in the middle of the summer. Apathy. Let's all show up with our beach towels and listen to the pastor talk about being lazy. So instead, I talked about murder and adultery and the Ten Commandments coming soon to a summer near you, Hill City Church. I am really passionate about this. And I think as Christians and spiritual people in this country, we have gotten to a place where faith has been dealt with a lot of apathy. And now hang with me on this, because here's where I think we are as a country. We don't need Jesus because we've got our money. We don't need Jesus because we've got our houses or our cars. And people, listen, I drive an Audi, and every once in a while somebody comes up to me and they say, oh, look at the pastor in his fancy German automobile. It's 12 years old and has 180,000 miles, and I know it's worth $2,000 because I've looked. And if you're willing to give me four, it's yours. And I have a beautiful home because I live in Roberts. If you live in Hudson, my house is worth a lot more, but I live in the literal sticks. Like if you go out to my house, you can pick up sticks. So I know these things. Entertainment, right? Just down the thing here, there's a movie theater, and as if being alone in a dark room with someone you love, watching a beautiful screen wasn't enough, they put in reclining chairs so that you can pay to fall asleep somewhere other than your home. We have sports, we have movies, we have music, we are entertained, all of us. We distract ourselves. And now, parents, we have a different problem, teaching our kids how to not distract themselves. Turn off the television, put away the video games. There's this thing outside called grass, put it on your pants. I will gladly rub out all the grass stains I can if my kid spends some time outside. And then we find ourselves in this place where something actually bad happens and we are struggling and it is awful. I mean, I understand this pain, right? My wife lost both of her parents within a year and a half. We are not We are not strangers to trauma. I get it. And I've told you about my letters, right? I have a diagnosis. And here's the deal. I know pain. I know trauma. I understand it completely. But this is what we do as in Western society. I'm struggling so bad. There's a pill for that. I take pills. They help me. I am not against pills. I'm just telling you, sometimes they're used like the of glove. I'm going to put my hand in this fire, but first I'm going to put on this glove, and now I don't feel anything. And if the pill isn't enough, then, you know, we go to drinks or something or someone else that is willing to take our mind off of our problem and become a distraction for us. And so we find ourselves believing that we don't need Jesus because we can overcome our problems with everything that we have on our own. And now we're in trouble because last week we canceled something that was this fantasy world where we're going to live forever and we never have to answer the question, what happens after I die? But apathy doesn't answer that question. What if your kid came up to you and said, what's going to happen after I die? Your answer, I mean, nobody wants that answer. Apathy doesn't answer the question. And the answer to the question should inform how we live now and what we do. Believe it or not, the Bible deals directly with apathy, and it talks about it a lot, and it answers all of these why questions that we talked about earlier with becauses. So here we go with the becauses. Revelation. Why not start at the end of the Bible? Because it's where all the good stuff is. Revelation chapter 3. Megan, throw it up there. There's an angel talking to the Apostle John. He's on an island. He's been boiled alive. He didn't die. They send him to an island. He's seeing visions. Excuse me.
There's my lung.
And they say that John just wrote down the vision, okay? And so Jesus is talking through the Apostle John. He sees this angel, and the angel is speaking on behalf of God and says this to the church in Laodicea, but really to all of us. I know your works. I know what you do, and it's neither hot or cold. And I would prefer that you were either hot or cold, but you are lukewarm. And because you are lukewarm and neither hot or cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. Those whom I love, I reprove and I discipline. So be zealous and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and I knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come to them and I will eat with them and they with me. And the one who conquers, I will grant that they will sit on my throne just as I have conquered and sat down on the throne with my Father. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Holy Spirit has to say to the church. Jesus is saying, hey, when someone comes to your house and they knock on the door, you know, your wife or your husband says, hey, there's someone at the door. And you go, No. You're talking to your kid, right? Hey, when I tell you to clean your room, and your kid looks back at you and goes, Not in my house. Then I go pick it up. He says this. I would rather you were cold. I would rather you were against me than this lukewarm thing. I will spit you out of my mouth. There is a 7-second delay on sporting events because the words that they say to each other are so bad that they don't want them broadcast on national television. But you know what makes people more upset than the words? If somebody spits on them. Because it's gross. It's disgusting. And God's like, this is what I think of lukewarm Christianity. Paul is a little bit nicer about it. He writes to the church in Thessalonica. He says, I command you, brothers, in the name of Jesus Christ, that you keep away from any brother who is walking in idleness and not in accord with the tradition that you received from us. Because you saw us and you want to imitate us. We were not idle when we were with you, nor did we eat anyone's bread without paying for it. But we toiled and labored. We worked day and night that we might not be a burden to any of you. And it was not because we do not have stuff or that we don't have the right for you to take care of us, but we gave you an example to imitate, because even when we were with you, we would give you this command: if anyone is not willing to work, let him not eat. For what we hear is that some among you are walking in idleness, not busy at work, but busy bodies. Oh, okay. Anybody here ever just push stuff around on their desk for a while? Right? Oh, there's my boss. What did you type? I don't know. Turn off the NCAA tournament, right? March, productivity. Just busy bodies, just walking around doing stuff, but nothing of any importance. Instead, encourage one another. Anybody who is a busybody should be encouraged to do their work quietly and earn their own living. As for you, brothers and sisters, do not grow weary of doing good, because if anyone does not obey what we say, take note of that person and have nothing to do with them, so that they will feel ashamed. Do not regard them as an enemy, but warn them as a brother. Strong words for how we deal with those whose faith is in a place of No Christian should aspire to be lukewarm, right? Jesus, through the Apostle John, says it's better for you to be against me than to be lukewarm. Paul says to the Thessalonians, we were not made to be lazy and idle. When I was with you, I was not those things, and you shouldn't be either. Why? Because Jesus wants better from us. We should be better than that. The writer of the book of Hebrews says this: about this we have much to say, and it is hard to explain, because you have become dull of hearing. For by this time you ought to be teachers, but instead, you need someone to again teach you the basic principles of the oracles of God. You need milk, not solid food. For everyone who lives on milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, and he is a child. A child. Milk does not do a body good in this instance. It's not pro-milk. I mean, yes, we all need milk, right? Mammals need milk when we're babies. They feed it to us so that we grow and we get a little bit fatter and we get a little bit, you know, more. Some of us had a little too much milk. But here's the thing. If you're 65 years old and you're still drinking only milk, people are going to look at you a little weird. Who's that guy and why is he only drinking milk? Have a dinner party, and okay, here's the 2%, and here's the skim, and here's the whole. Where's the food? Dan, you're 40-something, right?
At least.
Okay. Internet, this is my friend Dan. He married my wife and I. I can pick on him a little bit. Dan's 40-something, give or take 20 years. I've known Dan a long time. Dan became a believer in his 20s, right? But just because Dan is 60-something doesn't mean Dan's any more mature of a Christian than the day he became one. He had to put in the work. He had to open his Bible. He had to be in relationships with people. He had to challenge them. I have met some people Dan's age who have been in church their whole life and are still the exact same person drinking the bottle. And that is not. Now, don't get me wrong. By the skin of their teeth, they are getting in because they have done the literal bare minimum. But we've been over this. That is not the goal, right? It is not when mom says clean your room, you walk in, you pick up a sock, and you go, cleaned the sock. Like, no. So you grow and you challenge yourself and you strive to be better. And eventually you're eating steak for every meal. And if that doesn't do it for you, I guess kale is an option. Jesus says we need to be better. The writer of Hebrews says milk is not the thing of choice. Get your act together and start growing and maturing so that you can teach other people about what it looks like to be a real follower of Jesus. You are the plan to teach other people what it looks like to follow Jesus. And the reason it is so important that you're eating real food instead of drinking milk is because of what's at stake. Because of what's at stake, listen to Paul write to his friend Timothy. He says, I charge you in the presence of God and Jesus Christ, who is to judge the living and the dead. I charge you to preach the word, be ready in season and out of season to reprove, to challenge and rebuke and exhort, to lift up and encourage with complete patience and teaching. Why? Because the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but they will have itching ears to accumulate for themselves teachers who will tell them what they want to hear, and they will turn away from the truth and wander away into myths. Can we just think about 2021 right now? Itching ears to hear what will help them do their own passions and desires. I'm telling you right now, all you have to do to find somebody who will tell you what you want to hear is Google it. You will find a pastor that will tell you what you want to hear if you Google it. How can I make more money? He continues, as for you, real followers of Jesus, be sober-minded, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, and fulfill the call of the ministry of your life. He writes a little bit later to the church in Galatia, let the one who is taught God's word share all things that are good with one who teaches. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. Whatever one sows, one will reap. For whoever sows from their flesh will reap the corruption of their flesh. But those who sow from the Holy Spirit and the Spirit of God will reap eternal life. That's what's at stake here, where people spend their eternities. So let us not grow weary of doing good, because in due season we will reap if we do not give up. So then, as we have an opportunity, do good to everyone, and especially to those who are in the household of faith, in the community that you belong to. We have some people who go to this church, husband and wife. They helped us start the church. Tony's an elder. Tony and Ingrid, they live just down the street here. They are what are called homesteaders, and I call it insanity. This is what they do. They raise or grow everything that they consume. They have goats. They have pigs. They have high tunnels, which are basically like giant greenhouses. They start planting in February and they stop picking in like December. They get January off. It's nuts. And you know what it has taught me about all of that stuff? I'm never gonna do it. Because I turn on their Facebook feed and I see Tony watching Ingrid plant stuff all day long. Someone has to hold the camera. I said it for service. He was here. She agreed with me. I know I'm never going to do that because I don't care enough to do it. I don't have the energy or the passion to do it. But here's the thing. The reason they do it is because they know what's at stake, right? Their health is at stake. Their mental sanity is at stake. Their kids don't even know what a television is, and that makes the rest of us feel like failures. And that's what they like. No, I'm just kidding. I
I so admire what they do. But I'm watching them and I'm going, I could never do that. But I have a clear, honest picture of what it looks like. Here's the problem. When Christians are apathetic, people look at us and they get a clear, not honest picture of what it should look like to follow Jesus. And they go, oh, I'm doing that. If that's all it is, I'm good. And they are tricked and they're deceived. And here's the thing. Like I said, some people are living in a relationship with Jesus and doing just the bare minimum. But there are people on the other side of that line who do not have a relationship with Jesus, who look at the people doing the bare minimum. And they go, well, we're the same. So I'm good too. And eternity is at stake. Where you spend eternity is reliant on whether or not you have a relationship with Jesus. And so they say he's coming again. Okay, so be ready. Why do we care? Because we need to be ready. Paul writes to the Thessalonians again. He says this, you yourselves are fully aware that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. And while that is about to happen, people will be saying, there's peace and there's security. Everything's fine. Sounds a lot like America right now, right? I mean, yeah, we've got issues that divide us and we've got, but when it really comes down to it, man, I wake up, I go to my job, I get in my car, I drive to work, I come home, I hang out with my family. Most of the time, we're fine. Got my money. Got my friends. I'm good. But then, listen to this. Sudden destruction will come upon them as labor pains upon a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. Ladies, can I get an amen? Here's the deal. My wife got pregnant. I looked right at her. I said, okay, the next 9 months are on you. Like, I'll help, but if I was the pregnant one, you'd have to knock me out because the anxiety would literally kill me. There's only one way this thing is coming out, and it is super painful. Alexa, I'm so sorry. I've heard it's unpleasant. They will not escape. All of a sudden, they're going to realize, wait a minute, there's something that comes next, and I'm not ready for it. But you're not in darkness. And that day will not surprise you like a thief because you are children of light, children of day. We are not of the night or the darkness. So then let us not sleep as others do, but be awake and sober-minded because those who sleep, sleep at night. And those who get drunk at night. But since you belong to the day, let us be sober and put on faith and love and salvation. In other words, when someone is breaking into your house, what is the last thing you want to be? Asleep. Right? Because you're asleep and then you have to reach for, I don't know what you reach. I've reached for a bag of cheese. That's what I keep. When the people want to break into my, here, I'm sorry, it's mozzarella. It's the best we could do. I don't know what you reach for. Maybe a baseball bat, maybe something else. I don't know what you're reaching for. I don't have any of those things at my house, so I reach for cheese. It's a, it's mold. People don't want it. Cheese is delicious. I'm sorry. But here's the thing. You don't want to be asleep when someone breaks into your house. You want to be ready. And we're looking at the rest of the world, and they're asleep. And way back in the Old Testament, in a book that some of you have never heard of called Zephaniah. Now, there's a name. God says this through the prophet. He says, at that time, I will search Jerusalem with lamps and I will punish those who are complacent and those who say in their hearts, the Lord does not do good, nor will he do ill. God doesn't care. God's not here. Their goods will be plundered and their houses will be laid waste. Though they build houses, they will not inhabit them. And though they plant vineyards, they will not drink any wine from them. In other words, you're going to do a whole bunch of work and it's going to mean nothing because your faith in God was meh. You see, we don't know the hour or the time when Jesus is coming back, and I promise you, when he does, you're not going to want him shaking you to wake you up like my kids are going to do later this afternoon when I'm taking a nap. Dad, the dogs are on fire. No. You don't want Jesus to come down and wake you up and say, hey, I know you're not ready, but the world's on fire and I'm here. And you don't want your friends and your neighbors to have that experience. So you have to be aware of what's at stake, and you have to be ready so that when the opportunity comes, you can welcome them into the kingdom. And if none of those things did it for you, if all of those things and you're still like, well, yeah, but not being apathetic is a lot of work. Maybe this one will convince you. The last reason that we should not be apathetic is because Jesus wasn't. Right? Jesus up in heaven, hanging out with God the Holy Spirit and God the Heavenly Father. I don't know how that all works. We can talk about that later. You're having tea or something, right? And God looks at Jesus and goes, all right, it's time to go down. And he goes, no way. He literally comes to earth, lives a human life, and then carries your sin, shame, regret, all of it. Literally carries it on his back and lays down his life so that you can spend eternity with God. That is about as action-minded as it can get. John records it this way, 1 John chapter 3. By this we know love, that Jesus laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers. But if anyone sees his brother in need and has the goods of the world and closes his heart towards him, how does God's love abide in them? Little children, let us not love in word or talk, but instead in deed and truth. You can talk the talk as much as you want. It does not matter unless you walk the walk. It's that simple. The example is God himself submitting, choosing, and allowing himself to be killed by his own creation. Jesus chose the cross. He carried our sins. He actively sought out new believers and taught them how to join the kingdom of God. You know, Jesus walking around and his disciples are like, hey, look, you know, there's a blind guy. You should go heal him. And Jesus goes, no. Hey, look, there's those sinners and tax collectors. There's that darn IRS again. And Jesus is like, I'll leave them. They'll figure it out. No. Jesus tells them directly and often about the cost of following God. We're talking about a man who lived with no house, no money, no wife, no kids, no reason to love us the way that he did. And yet every act of his life reflects his commitment to us. So here's my question for you, and I ask it of myself too. My why question is this: why would you want to live an apathetic life? Why would you want to live an apathetic Christian life? Because I know what it gets you. There's a band I listen to, they're kind of a punk band, so their lyrics are kind of fun and silly, and they released this album called The Apathetic EP, and it's all about like laying on your couch and lazy days in the sun, and it's all fun. But one of the lines in one of the songs says, apathetic is a pathetic way to be. And especially when it comes to our faith, that could not be more true. Because apathetic doesn't just mean lazy. It doesn't just mean that we don't care. It means that it reflects poorly and inaccurately on the God that we serve, and it gives people the false hope and idea that what it looks like to follow Jesus is basically no different than the world in which they live. And And so Paul writes to the Romans and says this, let your love be genuine. Hate what is evil, hold fast to what is good. Love each other with brotherly affection. Outdo each other in showing honor. Do not be slothful, but be fervent in spirit and serving the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in tribulation. Be constant in prayer and continue to meet the needs and contribute to the needs of the saints and show hospitality. Look at the action words in that sentence. Over and over and over again. Do, be, act. So my question, why? Why live an apathetic Christian life? What benefit is it to you? Because this is what it gets you. Three things. Shame, guilt, and a feeling that you could have done better. Every time. I really wish I had said. Man, I wish I hadn't given in. They're never going to forgive me. An apathetic Christian life gets you shame, guilt, or the feeling that you could have done better. And people, I'm just going to be honest with you, that sounds awful to me. That alone motivates me to want to follow Jesus more with my life. And what does apathy, your apathy, get others? A false sense of what following Jesus really looks like. So here's the truth about apathy. It helps no one. And it hurts everyone. And so we need to start living the Christian life like the world is on fire. Because it is. And we have the only thing that offers respite and reprieve. We have the Spirit of God that lives inside of us. The very God that spoke creation into being wants to live inside of us and welcome us into God's presence for eternity. And that is nothing to be about. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for the example of your Son, for the actions of your Son on this earth as he carried his cross weighed down by our guilt and our sin and our shame. This morning, Lord, we will remember his body broken for us and his blood shed so that we could live with passion and zeal, so that we could seek to serve you in ways that you have called us to, that we could be called into action. God, I pray that as we eat this bread and drink this cup, it would be a reminder of all that you have done for us, and it would inspire us to do something for you. God, as we sing these songs and they remind us of who you are and who you call us to be, would you lift our hearts together as one and unify them with your own? God, what a blessing it is to be in your presence this morning. To be inspired by the God, the creator of the universe, who cares about every one of us uniquely. We praise you and we thank you for this. In Jesus' name, we worship you today. Amen.
Thank you. How great is your love for us?
God like you, a love so true. There has never been, there will never be a God like you.
Okay, here's the thing. You all think that I plan this out and I know what I'm going to say when I come down here when everything is over. I have no idea. I'm standing up there, I'm singing, I'm playing the drums, and something magically shows up in my head, right? First service, I talked about Tony and how I was sorry I made fun of him. And you know. Come here. Right in here is a real live human thing.
It's a what?
A girl.
It's a girl. I remember all the time. And maybe today. Today?
I don't know.
Soon, and very soon, Mom and Dad are gonna get to hold that living thing, and they're gonna love it, and people are gonna look at Mom and Dad and they're gonna say, look at the love they have. And they get a little older and then you go, eh. Right? But here's the thing, they're gonna look at Scott and Alexa and they're gonna say, how great is the love that they, and I'm sorry, but that pales in comparison to the way God loves you. And nobody would want to see Mom or Dad pour love and grace and forgiveness and effort and teaching into that baby and for that little girl to someday look at them and go, eh. No, Mom, I love you. Dad, I love you. Thank you for treating me this way. I'm going to raise my kids the way you raised me. I'm going to do all these things. That is the passion and the energy, the way they're going to raise and look at this little baby is the way God looks at you and the way he wants you to spread his love to the rest of the world. There is no plan B. It is you and it is me. And the best thing about this church is that I am surrounded by people who love the Lord passionately. They do not have to raise this little girl alone. We are going to stand alongside them and help them passionately and tremendously. There's another one right there. That one's a girl too. I remember these things. She was crying. I'm sorry. I'm forgetting. Is anyone else here pregnant? Okay. No. Just remember the first time you held a baby in your arms, and if it was yours, oh, there was something about it. And it's coming. Sorry. She's not that excited, but she will be. Christian life was not meant to live. Do yourself a favor and just go all in. It is so worth it. Thank you for being here. Thank you for being a part of this church. So blessed. I do not do this alone ever. I am surrounded by people who do this the right way. It makes it so much fun. Such a blessing. Have a great week. Don't forget your kids.